Hey guys, it's Nick. Welcome to another episode of T-Minus 365. Today's episode, I'm covering the updates from September of 2023 from Microsoft. If you've followed my update videos in the past, you know I focus in on what's relevant to the MSP space, blocking out the noise from the 100 or so announcements that come from Microsoft each month. As a quick reminder, I do always supplement this video with a blog post with a lot more information about all of these announcements, including helpful tutorials like videos and things like that. So be sure to check that out after you're done watching this video. Getting into it here, the first announcement is something that we're all very excited about, very much hype fest going on right now around Copilot. These announcements were more related to the recent updates as well as some of the GA timelines that we will be looking at here. The video tutorial that you're seeing is really related to just Windows 11 and some of the updates there to both the OS and some of the native applications on the OS as well too that you get, like Paint in that example just there. But effectively here, they've announced the preview September 26th with the latest update to Windows 11. This is going to be free for consumers here that are on that version of the OS. And so by the time you're watching this video, you might be able to get into that preview there as well. But effectively, the other big announcements here that we're all waiting for is around the general availability of M365 Copilot. And so they announced the general availability for enterprise customers, or EA customers, starting on November 1st. And then there's subsequent announcements that relate to CSP and when we'd be able to resell this down to our customers, which currently are going to be at the end of Q1 of 2024. At our MSP, we're currently in the public preview for M365 Copilot, and I will say that I do believe it's going to be a game changer, a lot of powerful features, and I've barely scratched the surface so far between Teams and Outlook. So more to come on this, but a lot of cool things coming from the AI front and a lot of focus there, but obviously there's a lot of security and compliance concerns when we get into that as well too. Shifting into Microsoft Teams here, this is specifically for Teams webinars. You can generate unique join links for external presenters so that they don't have to go into the lobby or you don't have to change their role after they've entered the session. You can see that between the screenshots here while you're scheduling the webinar on the left. And then on the right, you can see the meeting invite link that they get that basically represents that they are a presenter and they have a unique link. This will happen late October and be complete by early November. This next one here is more informational. I don't see a lot of people adopting this, especially not in the SMB space or MSP space, but maybe in the next 5 years, we'll all be in this kind of landscape here. This is specifically around immersive spaces, which is using Microsoft Mesh, which they partnered with Meta for the VR headsets that you would use for this. But it's basically giving you a 3D experience for your Teams meeting events. And you can see that more so in the screenshot here. But giving you this experience, and this is going into that public preview early in October of this year. And again, don't think a lot of people will adopt this, but more information in my blog post as well if you want to check it out. Next one here, they're introducing something called Town Hall for a meeting experience that's going to eventually replace the Teams live events. So this is more of a consolidation of a lot of the meeting experiences they've had, but it applies to both internal large-scale events as well as the external events that you would want to host as well. Full list of features I have in my blog post with the links back out to the actual Microsoft articles around this. But the big thing is if you're using Teams live events, they will be deprecated. They've got about a year till end of life now that Microsoft states, but if you've not started on it, you might as well get started on Teams Town Hall as far as the actual events goes, because that's where the future is going to be. This will happen in early October. Next one here is related to this Outlook add-in to support multi-tenant and multi-account scenarios. So if you're familiar with the tenant switching features in Teams, if you have multiple profiles across different organizations, you're able to switch very easily, and they made that a much more seamless approach over the past few years here. This is extending that into Outlook so you can configure a meeting bridge based off of that unique profile. You can see that here in the screenshot. So just giving you some more flexibility when you have access into multiple tenants or multiple accounts there. This is GA today, so you can go ahead and check that out. Last one here for Microsoft Teams is related to the new Teams client for Mac. And we've all kind of, I think, gone through the new Teams client for Windows. Whether or not it's better is subject to kind of your own experience. I've heard mixed from a lot of people out there, but the new Teams client is supposed to be much less resource intensive and have some new features in there as well too. And this is extending that to a preview on Mac devices as well. So it happened early September. So by the time you're watching this, it should be in preview already. Shifting into Microsoft Entra ID here again, previously Azure AD. This one is specific for security events. If you're using the identity protection and risky user reporting within Microsoft as well too. So this is extending certain security to hybrid environments. If you're syncing up from local Active Directory and on-premise environment and using password hash synchronization for your AD accounts that are pushing up into the cloud. Previously, prior to this, it wasn't recognizing any password resets that were going on locally, and that wasn't remediating the user risk that you would have in Entra. So this is extending that so that now whenever somebody's password is reset within the local Active Directory environment, it will reset the user risk in Entra as well too. So pretty cool feature, giving flexibility to hybrid environments. This is in a preview state right now. GA timelines are still to be coming out here in the future, but you can check that out now, especially if you're using the identity protection features. The next one here, I think a lot of us are familiar with, but this is something that's been in preview for a while, and it's a really great security feature in my mind. So I wanted to pull it up here, which is conditional access overview, dashboard, and templates. So the dashboard, which is in the screenshot down below, can give you insight into all of your conditional access policies, can actually identify where you might have gaps from the applications or users that are signing in across the logs that you have as well too. And it can also identify things like devices that are non-compliant that are signing in as well. So it's a great view into kind of more of the holistic security around access. But then the templates are also great pre-bucketized or pre-built templates that you can apply easily to your organization that really relate to some really high level security that you would want to implement, such as enforcing or blocking legacy authentication as a clear example of that. So if you haven't checked this out, definitely go into the Entra ID Admin Center, go into the security section there for conditional access to view this information. Shifting into Microsoft Intune here, this is advancing remote help. If you're not familiar with remote help, it's basically a remote access tool that's part of Intune that's been out for a few months now. And as far as the general availability, it is part of the Intune Suite add-on. So it's an additional cost. It's not part of your Intune base licensing that you would get, but it is an alternative to tools like Screen Connect from ConnectWise or LogMeIn or SplashTop or anything like that. They've updated this though, just want to make some notes on that, where they've extended support into macOS, which is great for that. And then the other thing they did is allowing you to launch the remote help sessions for Windows devices within the Intune Admin Center. So previously, a technician would have to connect locally to the user's device and do that kind of outside the ecosystem of Microsoft and the Admin Center. This is much more parity with typical remote access tools where you can do that from the Admin Center as well. This is GA now, so if you're leveraging this or want to check out remote help, there are free trials available as well if you want to check this out. Shifting into Microsoft Outlook here, this is extending support for Outlook on the web, where you can have some notifications around mapping time zones for particular meetings that you want to schedule. This is a cool one for me because we have in my organization, we have users across the United States. So it's really helpful to easily pinpoint times that would work for all of us. And if you're at a global scale, this is again, very much a value add to you to being able to easily schedule meetings that meet with everybody's or accommodate for everybody's schedules across those time zones. So they'll happen mid-October, be complete by late October. So shifting into Microsoft Defender here, we have a couple of announcements. The first one's related to the required configuration for phishing simulation emails. So if you're leveraging Exchange Online Protection or Defender for Office 365, but layering on a third-party tool for phishing simulations like KnowBefore or something like that, you have a specific policy that you want to deliver or create, which is the Advanced Delivery Policy, which when they say optimal behavior, it means that it's not going to go ahead and quarantine those emails or use the safe links, safe attachments for those links as well too to block them, because that defeats the purpose of the simulation itself. So you can read more about the policy and how to configure that within the blog post that I supplement, but that's going to be necessary for the most advanced behavior if you want to leverage those third-party tools. The other one here is related to tenant allow block list to support URL TLD blocking. So TLD is top level domain, but this is to say you could block certain TLDs like .biz or something like that that are very uncommon, but also are email domains or top level domains that are usually related to spam or malicious type of actors that might be sending information into the accounts. So you can go ahead and block those as well. This will happen late September and be complete by late October. And then finally here, Microsoft Purview. This is newer for a lot of people, but Purview as is offering is part and bolted on to a lot of our base level offerings like Microsoft Business Premium, for instance. And the audits that are part of Microsoft Purview are also applicable to some of or most of the base level licensing, even Business Standard, things like that. What this announcement's related to is the default retention time period for the standard offering, which again is part of Business Premium, those types of offerings as well too. It's changing from 90 days to 180 days. And the default retention for the premium offering of this remains at 1 year. But I think this is a great update just for security purposes because this is giving you a 6-month rolling retention period of those logs that you can use to do different audits across the various suite offerings from Microsoft, including Exchange and those types of environments where we do perform a lot more audits for certain levels of activity. So it's a great security win for this one. This will happen early October and be complete by mid-October. So that's everything I have for you guys in today's video. Be sure to leave any comments with any questions you have about these announcements or the features that you're most excited about. And as always, go ahead and like and subscribe if you guys want to see more content around Microsoft and the MSP space. Thanks, guys. I'll see you next week.